Hello, and welcome to the first talk in the 3IE How-To series. This series will provide a step-by-step guide to the production and use of impact evaluation. This first talk deals with building a theory of change. So what is a theory of change? A theory of change documents the links between inputs, activities, outputs, intermediate, and then final outcomes, and identifies the assumptions underlying that causal chain. These assumptions are the things that need to be in place in order for the links in the causal chain to operate. Let's see an example from a school feeding program. Like many education interventions, school feeding aims to improve learning outcomes. And it does that both by children being present, attending school, and being more attentive whilst they're there. And that happens because the school feeding program being in place encourages parents to send their children to school and increases the attentiveness of those children as they're not hungry, haven't got rumbling stomachs during the school day. There are assumptions underlying this short segment of the theory of change that we're showing in this slide. A first such assumption is that other inputs need to be in place. It's no use children being in the classroom and being attentive in the classroom if there are no teachers. So there's high teacher absenteeism, then a school feeding program might affect attendance, but won't actually improve learning outcomes. Secondly, food needs to be available in sufficient quantity and quality for the meals to be prepared. These are the sort of assumptions that a theory-based impact evaluation will be testing as part of the evaluation design. So what are the steps in building a theory of change? The first step is to be clear about the intervention, its objectives, and the outcomes that it hopes to achieve. The second step is to lay out the causal chain and then the underlying assumptions. The fourth step is to add a temporal dimension to that theory of change, which is required for planning or impact evaluation. Having done all that, we can identify the evaluation questions, and then, having done that, we should seek to validate, if necessary, revise the theory of change with key stakeholders. Let's now go through each of these steps in a bit more detail. First of all, clearly identify the intervention, its objectives and outcomes of interest. Be precise in your outcome definition and proposed measurement. And when you're thinking about the theory of change, be aware that you may identify unintended outcomes you also need to test for in your evaluation design. So, what is the intervention? It's school feeding. But there are many specific details we need to be aware of to construct the theory of change and to evaluate the intervention. Which meal is being provided? Breakfast, midday meal, mid-morning snack? Do guidelines exist as to the content of the meal? How is the food going to be procured? What's planned to ensure that parents, including parents whose children are not currently in school, know about the programme? And what training, if any, is going to be provided to those who are responsible for preparing the school meal? We may also identify unintended outcomes. Here's the segment of the theory of change that we looked at earlier. And we said that children eat the meals. Well, if the meals are provided during school hours, then actually less time is being spent in the classroom, so the programme might actually result in lower learning outcomes. So our evaluation design has to be prepared in a way we can test for this possible displacement effect. Moving on to steps 2 and 3, where we lay out the causal chain and identify the underlying assumptions. Some points in doing that are don't use silos. Be very specific in the details and the causal links in the theory of change. And when you're thinking about the programme, have empathy of intended beneficiaries to see the programme from their perspective. Here's an example of the school feeding programme presented in silos, where all the inputs lead to all the activities, lead to all the outputs, to all the outcomes. But in reality, specific activities like distributing foodstuffs, relate to specific outputs, the meal being provided. And so laying out the theory of change, not in silos, but this way instead, makes it very clear where the specific activities are that lead to specific outputs. This presentation of the theory of change clearly identifies the assumptions underneath the flow chart, which shows how the inputs lead to activities, to outputs, to intermediate, and then final outcomes. Secondly, have empathy of intended beneficiaries. See the project from their perspective. They're going to wonder who the project staff are and what they really want. It's not usual to come and offer free stuff. So what's the project doing to gain the confidence and trust of intended beneficiaries. What are the benefits that the beneficiaries are going to receive? Are they large enough to be judged important enough to take part in the programme, given actually what are the costs of participation, which are at least for time of the beneficiaries, but often they need to also purchase or have available complementary inputs. Moving on to step four, the temporal dimension, define the project timeline accurately and realistically, and think through the time required to observe a change of sufficient magnitude in sufficient people to make it sensible to measure impact. Let's take the school feeding example. Higher attendance you can probably measure even after 1 year of the programme. Attentiveness also. Higher learning outcomes, it might take 2-3 years of accumulated better schooling to see that emerge. But the thing we really want to achieve with a school feeding programme, like most educational interventions, is that better educated people go on to have higher productivity and higher lifetime earnings. And to measure that impact, we'd have to wait a lifetime. We're not going to do that. We should be aware that's part of our theory of change, and we're actually ignoring that part and using the proxy final outcome of higher learning outcomes. Step five is to now identify the evaluation questions. Really interrogate the causal chain to ask what needs to be in place for this programme to operate. Think about different types of evidence that we might need and probing for potential weak links in the causal chain. And finally, thinking about second generation questions which address design issues. Let's look at each of these. What needs to be in place? These are the assumptions underlying the theory of change. We spoke about some of these earlier. Let's look at two different ones. First of all, parents need to be aware of the programme, including parents who don't have children in school, in order to send their children in school to benefit from the school meal. So what's the project doing to ensure there is that awareness, and what awareness is there amongst parents in the communities where the school feeding programme is taking place? Secondly, you need to have appropriately qualified and motivated project staff. Are they in place for the project to be carried out as planned? To test these assumptions, we need different types of evidence. We need to have both factual evidence and counterfactual evidence. The factual evidence describes what happens in programme areas. The counterfactual evidence captures what happened in programme areas compared to what would have happened in the absence of the programme. And so it requires a rigorous impact evaluation design of the sort we'll be talking about in subsequent lectures in the how-to series. But for the moment, let's focus on some factual evidence. So for example, those trained by the project should understand the tasks they've been asked to do and required to do for the programme to work. Let's think how we might measure that. Well, for example, we might go out and give a written or verbal test to a representative sample of those that have been trained by the programme. Let's take a second factual piece of data. Are nutritious meals being served in the correct portions? How might we test that? Well, we could go to the schools, unannounced visits during mealtime, and actually observe the meals which are being served, the size of the meals and the content of those meals. What are the potential weak links in this causal chain? Has the equipment been distributed? And if it has been distributed, is it usable? Maybe electric equipment has been provided to schools with unreliable or even no electricity. And finally, what are the second generation questions we might ask? What are questions that help us understand how better to design school feeding programmes? So for example, what procurement system is going to be used? National procurement or local procurement by the schools? A second example would be which meal? Breakfast or midday meal has a higher impact on attendance and attentiveness and therefore learning outcomes. Finally, step six. Having drawn up our theory of change, we need to validate it and necessarily revise it by consulting key stakeholders, programme managers, intended beneficiaries and so on. I call this a theory of change walk because you take these stakeholders through the theory of change step by step, asking for their views about these different steps. An example is a school voucher programme where the programme is intended to increase students going to private school, they get a better education, therefore higher learning outcomes and a better life. I presented this theory of change to Department of Education staff in the Philippines and they said, no, that's not why we have school vouchers at all. Sure, that may happen, but the major problem we have in secondary education in the Philippines is overcrowding. And so for us, the purpose of school vouchers is to take some students out of the system, they go to private education, But what we're interested in is those students who remain in the public system and the fact they now have a lower pupil-teacher ratio and therefore they get higher test scores. That's why we're doing school vouchers. So without that validation of speaking to Department of Education staff, the impact evaluation would have been misdesigned, looking at the impact only of those getting the vouchers and not actually the benefit of those who stay behind in the public school system. So let's just repeat the steps in building a theory of change. First, be clear on the intervention, its objectives and outcomes. Second, draw out the causal chain and the underlying assumptions. Add the temporal dimension. Identify your evaluation questions. And finally, validate and revise the theory of change. So thank you for listening to this talk. I hope you'll go on and take the quiz associated with this talk, and you'll go on and listen to subsequent talks, and indeed encourage your friends and colleagues to do so also.